Good morning, Your Honors. Mary Christine Sangaila of Haynes & Boone on behalf of Appellant Nabors Completion and Production Services Company. I would like to reserve 3 minutes for rebuttal. This court should reverse the district court's order and require this wage and hour dispute to be arbitrated as the parties agreed. Established case law and the policy of the FAA favoring enforcement of arbitration agreements as written compels that result. Plaintiffs have not carried their burden of establishing that the agreement is unenforceable. To do that, they must show that it is both procedurally and substantively unconscionable. That is, that the agreement was both obtained by surprise or oppression and also contained overly harsh or one-sided provisions that shock the conscience. First, procedural unconscionability. There was no surprise or oppression. Notice of the dispute resolution program was expressly set forth in documents that the plaintiffs signed both at the time of their application and at the time of
employment. Along with a whole lot of other documents in it. You know, it's not first and foremost, and it wasn't explained to them specifically, and as it has been in some other cases where we've said there was no unconscionability.
Well, but there is case law, the California Supreme Court's decision in Baltazar does indicate that when you have a take it or leave it provision in connection with employment, that there may be some very low level of procedural unconscionability.
There is some level,
there's some level of procedural unconscionability. My question, but because your time is not too long, I'm not as concerned with unconscionability as I am with what is the correct analysis of the PAGA claims. We know that PAGA claims can't be waived, but that doesn't mean they can't be arbitrated necessarily.
Correct.
And as I understand it, it's a little bit like that the state has necessarily declined to prosecute these claims, and so it's left to, if someone wishes to do it as a private attorney general, they can. So what's your best understanding of what happens to these claims, whether they can or cannot be arbitrated?
Okay, well, I do I agree with you that Iskanian and Sakab, both within their holdings, only discuss that the first question that you mentioned, which is, hey, you can't completely give up these claims.
Right.
So you cannot waive entirely the PAGA claims. And
the PAGA waiver in the arbitration agreement is unenforceible.
Under Iskanian and Sakab.
Right. So are these claims arbitrable?
Well, yes, we have an alternative provision if the collective and class action waiver.
The question I think we're both asking, and I don't doubt that the arbitration agreement says they're arbitrable.
Mm-hmm.
My question is, are they arbitrable in the nature of the claims? These are claims these are the state's claims. These are the state's enforcement claims, which are being brought by a private attorney general. The state has consented to let the private attorney general bring them. But has the state consented to arbitration?
Well, and I do understand, although we have not briefed the cases that have come down since our briefing ended.
Well,
there has been quite a few.
There's a couple of members that say they're arbitrary, that you can order them to arbitration, but that they're not precedential.
Right.
So the question is, given the strange nature of these PAGA claims, it's really they're like QI-TAM claims.
Exactly.
Are QI-TAM claims arbitrable?
Yes. Some recent case law, including a decision out of the Southern District of Ohio, indicates that
which we always follow.
I'm just saying I'm deferring to your colleague from Ohio. Yes. In fact, some courts have found that they are arbitrable. And likewise, the PAGA claims should be arbitrable.
I have a question, too, about the passage in Sakab that suggests that the parties are free to agree to arbitrate such claims. But I was not clear whether that counts as dictum or whether that is in some way more binding. It's certainly a suggestion, but...
Well, and Iskanian has the same language, right? We really don't sort of care which way you go as long as you're able to bring these claims somewhere.
Well,
and
but that's here's my difficulty to respond mm-hmm. to it, because there is plenty of authority to support your point. The result in this case will bind the state of California with respect to those PAGA claims. It won't bind any individuals because they retain their individual causes of action, but it will end the PAGA case. Agree? If this is arbitrated, whichever way it comes out, it will bind the state of California and no second PAGA case could be brought. The Attorney General couldn't wake up the next day and say, oops, I passed up a big opportunity. This was you'd come into court and say it was arbitrated already. We're done. So,
and the Attorney General has had many opportunities.
Right.
They wanted
that.
To collect it through
that.
Citation.
My concern, and the one I want you to try to respond to, is mm-hmm. that when the Attorney General said to the plaintiff in this case, I'll give you my rights to bring the PAGA claim, did he also say, and I'm perfectly happy if they're arbitrated as opposed to brought in court? Does he do that with the knowledge that whatever rights and obligations the plaintiff has, he has to, his PAGA claim is...
Well, and as this court has noted in the Porter versus Nabors decision, the plaintiff pursues the PAGA action, quote, in his own name, exercise complete control over the lawsuit, and is not restrained by any provision of the PAGA statute from settling or disposing the claim
agree.
As he sees fit.
Absolutely agree.
And therefore,
no,
the plaintiff...
I'm moving back in time. The mm-hmm. Attorney General at some point, state says to the PAGA plaintiff, go bring this case. We're not going to bring it, right? They have to go to ask for permission to bring it.
They have to give the attorney, the state, the opportunity to do its own citation if it wants
right.
to.
And
now,
the state,
unlike a False Claims Act, is not part of the, an active part of the litigation after that. And also prior to that, if the government itself wanted to get these penalties, it would neither have to arbitrate nor go to court. It would just say, we're citing you for these penalties.
Okay, so...
So this is actually, arbitration or litigation is more than the state would actually get if it were doing it itself.
But you do agree that the result in the case would preclude a second suit by the state?
For the exact same thing.
For the exact same violations.
Well, I think the California Supreme Court case law says that, right?
Yeah, so
that
yes, is your answer.
Yes, I mean under governing case law. Yes, but I think the question is: at which point do you look at this question? In other words, did the plaintiff have the power to bind the state to this particular method of proceeding? I think the answer goes back to at the time that PAGA was enacted, every employee in California now has the potential claim for this, right? The legislature said you have the potential to have this claim. And at that point, and each individual plaintiff has to have that claim themselves in order to bring a PAGA claim. It is not purely on behalf of the state. It is not purely on
well,
behalf
that's,
of
that's
others,
not true because,
right? Look, they have to have standing.
I understand your point, but a second plaintiff, once this PAGA claim is litigated or arbitrated and the award is confirmed, a second plaintiff could not bring a PAGA claim. That's California law. The second plaintiff could bring a claim on his own behalf for injuries that he or she suffered, but they couldn't bring a PAGA claim on behalf of the state for penalties.
Assuming
the suit is preclusive. It's done.
Assuming that to the extent the PAGA claims are the representative PAGA claims.
They're all representative PAGA claims. Nobody brings an individual PAGA claim. They're bringing a claim on instead of the state attorney general seeking penalties. The statute gives them a bounty for doing so, but it's not
their
individual claim.
Well, the labor code says that a PAGA action may be brought by an aggrieved employee on behalf of himself or herself and other current or former employees. So there are actually two components.
I agree with Judge Hurwitz. Once it's brought, it's brought. And it operates the same way as issue preclusion or claim preclusion, correct?
There can't be a second PAGA action. Let's assume this one went through to completion in arbitration. An award was given. I don't care which side wins. Somebody goes to court and confirms the award. That's the end of PAGA for this set of alleged violations, is it not? By this individual, the state, or any other individual?
Well, to the extent that, right, that this plaintiff brings both their own PAGA claim and representative on behalf of others.
You can't have an individual PAGA claim. There are no individual, it's a representative, it's an action on behalf of the state seeking penalties. The state's claim to get penalties is you've said so, it's extinguished by the PAGA action. There can't be a second individual PAGA action later on based on the same violations that are being alleged here. I mean, I hope your client's got to hope that, because you don't want 500 employees bringing PAGA actions.
And you could have inconsistent results.
You have used up your time. We'll give you a minute for rebuttal when the time comes.
Thank you.
Since we had a lot of questions, we'll hear from Mr. Wickham.
Good morning, Your Honors. My name is Douglas Wickham, and I represent appellants Tidelands and the City of Long Beach. In my instance, my client is sued in this action in a declaratory relief claim relating to a contract between Tidelands and the City of Long Beach to determine, at least according to the plaintiffs, that agreement is subject to the prevailing wage laws of the state of California. My client was sued in this case because we also, the Tidelands is the general contractor to Nabors, and so on the one hand they are asserting the PAGA claims and other claims against Nabors, and then at the same time they're seeking a declaration that the main contract between the City of Long Beach and Tidelands is a prevailing wage contract. My clients are entitled to take advantage of and to enforce the dispute resolution program by the very terms of the agreement, that my client is an intended third-party beneficiary of the agreement. If you look at the definition of the company, the definition within the DRP itself necessarily includes anyone who is alleged to be jointly and severably liable with Nabors. Also, separately, the definition of the company says that Nabors' agents are also within the ambit of the defined term company. And in plaintiff's complaint in the action in the trial court, they specifically allege that my client is jointly and severally liable with Nabors, as well as that my client.
I guess this is a question that should go to your opponent, but the way I read the briefing, is there really an argument that if the dispute between Nabors and the plaintiff has to go to arbitration, that your dispute doesn't go along?
Judge Pregerson did not rule on that issue.
That's what I'm saying.
Judge Pregerson went straight to the issue.
It seems to me just derivative. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe the other side has another argument. But isn't it just derivative of the question of whether or not the plaintiff's dispute with Nabors goes to arbitration?
We would agree, because this panel has de novo review over the matter, rather than sending it back to the trial court to resolve the issues that had not previously been resolved, we're asking the panel actually
So enlighten me on the record below. Did your opponent argue below that even if Nabors is entitled to arbitration, you're not?
He did, Your Honor.
Okay.
And his arguments below dealt with his arguments below, as well as in this court, they were arguing that my client was not a so-called electing entity, and because my clients were not an electing entity, they were not able to.
Even if you're not entitled to arbitration, wouldn't the appropriate thing to do in this case be to stay any litigation pending a determination of whether or not in the arbitration Nabors had violated any agreement with?
Well, we would assert that because the declaratory relief claim is asserted both against Nabors as well as against my clients, that claim, if it's arbitrable, then my clients also, under the doctrine of equitable estoppel, should be able to enforce the arbitration agreement and participate in that. My clients are very interested in the issue of whether and to what extent the contract between the City of Long Beach on the one hand and Tidelands on the other hand is a contract which calls for the prevailing wage. And so as a consequence, because all
you'd
of
want
these
to
issues,
participate in the arbitration.
Well, because
or
all
that,
of these issues,
your position.
That's exactly right. And because all of these issues are intertwined under the doctrine of equitable estoppel, that's an additional reason why it is that we're entitled to enforce the agreement. Turning to the and I will assert that we had made the various arguments about why, as a non-signatory to the agreement, we're entitled to enforce it. Because we're an intended third-party beneficiary, because of the doctrine of equitable estoppel, that those particular points and those particular arguments were not opposed in Appellee's brief. So that's
why I was asking the question. Judge Pregerson didn't rule on it. There doesn't seem to be a counter-argument from the other side. So I'm just trying to figure out whether this is an issue that's really contested anymore.
We want to make sure that we... if the court is inclined to reverse the district court, that it do so, and that we send the claims against my two clients to arbitration as well. With regard to the validity of the arbitration agreement itself, I starting backwards in time, the issue of severability is one that has not been fully explored in federal courts, more so it has been in the California Supreme Court, that starting with the Armendariz decision back in 2000, the Armendariz court had directed that if you were to find the agreement was substantively or unconscionable, that there still is a general direction that the agreement should be enforced if the provisions are severable.
So I'm interested in that. We have two provisions here that the other side says are unconscionable. Well, three, but we need to focus on two of them. One of them says... basically, everybody bears their own costs in the arbitration, but for the payment of the $150 fee. If we severed that, how would costs be allocated? No, we're not entitled to rewrite it. All we're entitled to do is sever something. If we were to sever it, how would costs be allocated in the arbitration?
The answer is straightforward, Your Honor, that those provisions dealing with allocation of fees and costs, in the first place, they don't all eliminate them. Several of the provisions say, except as ever otherwise provided by law. And with regard to
It would either go back to the statutory default, or if there isn't a statutory default, it would be up to the arbitrator.
You say leave it up to the arbitrator, but we have a commandment in the arbitration agreement under Section 8 where the arbitrator shall have the authority to award any relief to a party, which necessarily includes cost shifting
so
at the end of the case.
So if there isn't an except as provided by law, which tells you go look at the statute, then it's up to the arbitrator.
That's correct, Your Honor.
We would
presume that the arbitrator will be doing his or her job in these instances, and that they would not be violating a law. That would be inconsistent with the expectations.
Were we to sever the what I would call the discovery provision, which is the provision that provides for limited discovery and then more at the discretion of the arbitrator, were we to say that were unconscionable? And I'm not saying we are going to. If we were to sever that, how would the arbitration proceed with respect to discovery? Is there any backup?
Once again, you revert back to the scope of the arbitrator's authority. The arbitrator is bound by and shall apply applicable law. To the extent that the California Supreme Court's decision in Armendariz is the controlling law, which at least at this point it continues to be, we do have arguments about Concepcion. But Armendariz commands that in arbitration, the litigants, the plaintiff, if they are asserting particular types of claims, is entitled to adequate discovery in order to be able to vindicate their claims.
Well,
what's
puzzling to me is that I don't read the discovery provision to differ from that in any way.
Nor do I.
Basically, what it says is, here are things you get as a matter of right. You get a list of witnesses, you get a list of documents, and for the rest of your discovery, the arbitrator can control the form and the timing and the scope. So it assumes there's more discovery. It just says, the arbitrator, like any judge, can say, well, it's not endless. Why don't you do it by, 2 months from today or whatever? I just don't see it as being different in any way from what would happen in court.
You're completely correct, Your Honor. I mean, the provision does provide for exchange of the names and addresses of witnesses
right.
and with documents. That's directly analogous to Federal Rule 26A, where you also have initial disclosures. The balance of the discovery provision says that it will be governed by and the tools available under the Federal Rules of Civil Procedure, subject to the arbitrator's discretion as to the form, frequency, and content of the discovery.
What limits the arbitrator's discretion? Because it almost seems that the arbitrator could have carte blanche, which could create a whole different set of problems for litigants particularly.
No. Yes and no, Your Honor. Once again, the arbitrator, by this agreement, which if the arbitrator varies from the agreement, then the arbitration decision would be subject to vacature. The arbitrator is bound to apply the applicable law. So at a minimum, the minimum standard that the D.C. Circuit articulated in Cole, the sufficient discovery that the California Supreme Court articulated in Armendariz, that is the applicable law. And at a minimum, the arbitrator would have to comply with that and order that minimum. I would go one step further that we or courts shouldn't have a presumption that arbitrators are going to be unreasonable, that they're going to be incapable to perform the challenges of the responsibility, and that they're going to act reasonably under the circumstances. If it turns out that the plaintiffs needed more discovery, they needed 10 depositions or 7 depositions or something like that, we should presume that the arbitrator will do his or her job, will exercise their discretion in good faith.
There's nothing that is baked in that would make sure that discovery is not unfairly limited, that would place an undue burden on employees.
There's baked into California and federal law on that subject from Armendariz that at a minimum it will not unfairly limit the employee's discovery. There's probably no similar protection for
employers. That's an arbitration specific rule though, so if we were to find that it made this unconscionable, we then have to get to your Concepcion arguments.
If Your Honors were to determine that that's an arbitration-specific rule, then that eliminates the argument entirely in terms of unconscionability.
Well, I mean, it depends. If we don't find it unconscionable, we don't need to worry whether it's an arbitration-specific rule.
Yes, Your Honor. I see that my time is up.
It is, and you also may have 1 minute for rebuttal
if anything comes
up that's about your issues as well. Mr. Donahue.
Good morning, Richard Donahue for the plaintiffs and appellants. I'd like to start with what the court was talking about on the discovery statute because it's the point that was just being made. If you read the arbitration agreement in that section carefully, what it says is a party only has to produce what they intend to use in the arbitration. It says that. It's subjective, what they intend to use. I'm a plaintiff. Most of the documents that I need will come from them to prove my case.
I understand, but it also says that the arbitrator may, in his discretion,
determine the amount of discovery, which is the same thing as saying the arbitrator may, in his discretion, deny all discovery.
Okay, so
it reads in such a way that it presumes there will be discovery because it says that the arbitrator can determine the format, the timing, and scope, but that it presupposes that there is discovery. Otherwise, it has no timing or scope or anything else.
This is a clause drafted by the employer's attorneys that says that the parties will give what they intend to put on at trial, not what the other side wants, which is real discovery, but what they intend to do. And then any discovery as to the amount shall be in the discretion of the arbitrator.
But the arbitrator can expand that using that full and fair exploration of the issues.
And can deny it to zero. And that's the point of Cole and Armendariz.
Okay, so I wanted to ask you about Cole and Armendariz. Let's assume you're right. Let's assume that Cole and Armendariz say that this kind of clause in an arbitration agreement is unconscionable. Then don't you run flat on it in Concepcion? Then we have a rule that applies only to arbitration agreements. And Concepcion tells us we can't enforce those.
Well, we may have to address that.
Well, but, try now.
Right, right. Well, we don't think that the conception should apply, and I know that I think the Supreme Court is going to deal with that probably sooner than rather than later. But
doesn't Concepcion flatly say that when you have a state rule, whether it's common law rule or a statute, that applies only to arbitration, the Federal Arbitration Act preempts that rule?
To distinguish it would be to say that's in the consumer context, has not, that point has not been necessarily applied in the employment context, which I think, you know, we could go on about all the differences between those two contexts, but here you're talking about someone's livelihood who they're trying to get a job, they're trying to apply.
Well, I guess so. I just have trouble reading the discovery provision as you do, because it's only subsection A that says the party submits its own intended list. But subsection B is separate, and it doesn't say anything or suggest anything about being only what the party wants to let you see.
Correct.
It doesn't suggest that at all. It presupposes that there's ordinary discovery, just like in court.
Well, I would submit that if it said the employee shall be entitled to minimum discovery that the arbitrator believes is necessary to vindicate their statutory rights.
Well, that would be one way to do it.
That would be one way to do it. But when you take the bottom minimum of discovery to allow an arbitrator under the terms of the agreement to go to zero.
See, I don't read it as doing that at all. That's what, okay. Because there are separate sections. One says you must give the list of witnesses and the documents. Separate section says the form and scope of discovery is to be at the discretion of the arbitrator. That presupposes there's a lot of stuff not covered in A, not what you intend to give as a list.
And I'll leave that with a respectful disagreement, Your Honor, only because it takes it, in my opinion, down when it says the arbitrator can determine the amount of discovery and it doesn't say anything about a minimum. Then
can a federal district judge do that? We have 26A, which says here's the mandatory discovery. And then there's all sorts of provisions in our rules, but they're all subject to the order of the court. Can a federal district judge in a case say, after mandatory discovery, you come to me and ask for permission before you do anything else?
Well, that would have to be a motion for good cause to be a protective order, because as it is now, the statute provides that you get discovery under the civil discovery rules.
But this also presupposes that you get discovery, and the arbitrator cannot decide no discovery. It doesn't say that. It says form, amount, and frequency. So right. There has to be some amount. There has to be some form, and there has to be some frequency.
I want to move to my other points. I just believe that when it says the amount, it's leaving the discretion to the arbitrator to say none,
and I think that
would be unconscionable. But
talk about your cost issue, because I know you want to get to that.
Right.
And let me tee it up for you. The American rule is that each party bears its own costs in litigation. That's what this agreement provides. Tell me what California case says this is unconscionable.
Sure. Well, Armendariz says it. It says that any cost or any cost to allow to burden a plaintiff to vindicate their statutory rights.
Yeah, but
the
costs that Armendariz talks about are entry costs. Those are costs. In other words, I have to pay the arbitrator in order to get into court, and I don't have to pay a judge in order to get into court except for a filing fee. So tell me a case that says that the inability to tax expenses during litigation is unconscionable.
I believe Armendariz goes to more than just cost. And I want to talk about what the judge...
You agree you can get attorney's fees if you win.
No, and that's what I want to talk about, because I made this argument below and Judge Pregerson did not address it.
We said you can get attorney's fees if you win? Wouldn't you like that?
Sure. But here's the problem.
Okay, so if we say that, then you've got no complaint about fees.
Well, here's the problem. What we're looking at here is whether or not this agreement was drafted with unconscionable terms, substantively unconscionable terms that were unfair or one-sided.
This is an even-handed term. It says that neither side may either each side will bear its own costs in litigating, correct?
This is what it says.
Not a one-sided term.
As to fees. This is what it says as to fees. Section 32B, all attorney's fees shall be borne by the party incurring them, except as otherwise provided by law, by the program, or in the award of the arbitrator.
So if you're entitled to fees as a matter of law, then you can get them.
That's a yes or no question.
No. If you're entitled to fees as a matter of law, the arbitrator can say, no, we don't care about the law?
That's what the agreement says.
No,
the
arbitrator shall not have the authority to abridge or enlarge substantive rights available under applicable law.
Okay, and you're reading on Section 30, which is a general.
Right.
Now you have a specific fee.
I just don't understand this argument. Don't you want to be able to recover fees?
I do.
The other side says you can.
I do. So here,
why don't we both just agree with you and say you can recover fees?
In California, including under the statute we brought, there are one-way fees. So if my client loses, my client does not have to pay their fees. They're one-way fees.
And if they award fees against your client, then they will be breaking the law. And you can come to a district court at confirmation and say, they're not awardable.
And the district court will read the sentence and the last six words.
What page are you on?
I'm on page, section 32. It's the or in the award of the arbitrator. It's the or. That word, or, allows. That word, or, allows the defendants.
Notwithstanding the other provision that says the arbitrator is bound by all substantive provisions
and
of law.
This is more specific because it's as to fees. So if
but he can ignore the law as to fees and award fees to the defendant.
That's what this says. This says all attorney's fees drafted by the employer, all attorney's fees shall be borne by the party incurring them, except as otherwise provided by law, by the program, or in the award of the arbitrator.
So you think if it's provided by law, the arbitrator can ignore the first clause and go directly to the third?
Correct. And that is substantively unconscionable, to allow an arbitrator to say.
Why should we interpret this agreement to lead to that ridiculous result? Shouldn't we, as Judge Pregerson did, interpret the agreement to say, no, the fee award must follow the law, not the whims of the arbitrator?
But if an agreement...
And if we say that, then the arbitrator would be bound by that.
Okay, so what does, I would submit, what does or in the, what does or mean?
Well, to me it means if the law doesn't tell you what to do, the program doesn't tell you what to do, the arbitrator can think about it and figure it out. It's hierarchical. It starts with the law, and if that doesn't answer it, you go to the program, and if that doesn't answer it, the arbitrator can think about it.
I would submit that in the way that is drafted, in the disjunctive or in the award of the arbitrator, at the very best, it's vague.
Okay. Well, if we were to say what we've just set up here in a decision of some sort, the arbitrator couldn't go anywhere else but there. Right.
That's correct.
Okay.
But what we end up, if the court is having, with all of these provisions, to rewrite or strike or sever or this, you're essentially rewriting an arbitration agreement.
In your favor.
Well, why can't we just excise the clauses that are unconscionable and leave the remainder of the arbitration agreement intact?
Well, in what I would submit that is the appropriate way to look at it is to take all of these provisions and include it in the sliding scale analysis of the procedural and substantive unconscionability, and then decide whether or not the agreement is unconscionable.
Well, let me move you to another issue, because I'd like your take on it as well. And that has to do with how we should treat the PAGA or PAGA, however we pronounce that, right, claims. We know they can't be waived. Does SACOB force us to say they're also arbitrable?
I don't believe they are arbitrable, because I do not believe that there's any agreement by the state to an arbitral form.
Well, why isn't the state, when it didn't respond to your notice, which effectively gives you the ability to bring the PAGA claims, why hasn't the state given up any of its rights and just made the PAGA claim subject to whatever obligations that your client has. In other words, the state has basically said, I don't care. You can bring it. And we're not going to monitor it. We're not going to supervise it. And now it turns out that the guy they let bring it has an arbitration agreement. Why should they care?
Actually, they do care because they get 75% of the money, and they are monitoring settlements, and they are attempting to use this to fund their enforcement activities.
But why do they care about the forum if they've given up the right to bring it?
I don't believe that they have. I would submit that if they had wanted to allow these things to be arbitrable, that they could have easily included that within the ambit of the statute under the Private Attorney General's Act to allow those things to be arbitrable.
But they don't expressly disallow it either. They just don't say.
Right. But I think arbitration, I think the law would say that in order for something to be arbitrable, there has to be a mutual assent. And there is no mutual assent of the state of California. And I think that's what Judge Pregerson was, how he was reading Iskanian with respect to that, and that's how Iskanian, I believe, interprets it. Is that
what do we do with the phrase in SACOB where it says this does not mean that a rule declining to enforce waivers of PAGA claims interferes with the FAA in any meaningful sense, since unlike class claims, parties are free to arbitrate them using the procedures of their choice?
Well, I don't think that's the holding of it. I would call that dicta, and I don't think that any court has issued a ruling stating that PAGA claims as a matter of law are arbitrable on a representative basis on behalf of the state of California, and that by being silent on the issue, the state has therefore waived or given or assented to the arbitrable of their claims.
But
of which
the state has remedies. The state can say, when it gets your notice, are you subject to an arbitration agreement? If
but
so, we're not going to give you permission to bring this.
Right, and they haven't. But in my humble opinion, that's not assenting to arbitration. And I think that until the legislature amends 2699 and says PAGA claims may be arbitrated on a representative basis.
But what the state is assenting to is having an individual pursue the claims. The state is not assenting to a place or a forum. The state is assenting to a person. And that seems different to me.
They're not assenting to arbitration.
If they're assenting to a person bringing a claim, however that person wishes to bring it, why not?
Because they have to assent to that. And I think the way that it's read and drafted is not assuming any alternative dispute resolution.
Why do you assume that? They're assenting to a person's ability, not to there's nothing that I see in there that limits where the person can go to assert that claim.
I'm out of time, but I would say, or no.
No, you're not.
Okay. I would state that arbitration is a matter of contract. It's not
a manner in which, though, interest can be vindicated. We don't dispute that you can't waive those PAGA claims.
Right. But
you still haven't told me anything yet other than it causes discomfort, perhaps, why these claims can't be arbitrated. It's just a matter of a forum.
To say that the right of the labor commissioner can be arbitrated without the assent of the labor commissioner or the state would, in my humble opinion, be new.
Can
the decision of the arbitrator be binding?
Well, I think an arbitrator's decision that binding to the state
on a PAGA claim, if it went through arbitration, it would be binding on the parties, right?
It may be they would purport it to be binding on the state of California, and that's what I think is the whole problem.
One of the strange things about this case is you're representing the plaintiffs, the individual plaintiffs. Why do you care if the state of California is discomforted? They've given you permission to bring the action. Right. You bring it in arbitration, you win or lose, Why are you here vindicating the interests of the state of California?
Well, I'm vindicating the rights of the state of California to obtain the penalties and to enforce.
I know, but you're representing a bunch of individuals who have a perfect ability to pursue the remedy in the forum that they signed up to do it in. The state of California wants to show up and object, they can do it. But why? How does the agreement become unconscionable because your clients are able to pursue the rights of the state of California in arbitration?
Well, the question is whether or not the PAGA claim in that regard is waivable and
well, waivable is you. Right. So I understand why you get to say it's not waivable because right. your clients are directly affected by that. Right. But why are your clients directly affected by where it gets litigated?
Well, with respect to the arbitration agreement, it is much more difficult to vindicate the statutory rights under this arbitration agreement for all the reasons we've already articulated,
okay.
including
the Here's a theoretical question for you. Could these individuals settle their PAGA claims if they wanted to?
Well, the
That's
law...
a yes or no question. Can they settle them?
The law says they can.
Okay. So if they can settle them and have no forum at all, and maybe give away part of the state's opportunity to collect 100%, why, I don't see theoretically why this is any more onerous on behalf of the state when they give you permission to pursue the claims as you see fit.
I'm not standing for the Attorney General in this particular manner, but I believe that the state does have an interest in the PAGA claim.
Does the state have to approve a settlement?
In a PAGA claim, they do have to get notice of it. They don't have to get approved. They don't approve
so
it.
Why didn't all their rights be vindicated if you go into an arbitration, you settle their PAGA claim, you give them notice, they have the ability to come in and say no, right?
They get notice.
And they can come in and say, no, we don't approve the settlement.
Technically, they could.
And your clients are not any worse off in arbitration of a PAGA claim than in any other fora. Is that right?
We believe that the arbitration forum is not advantageous or is not equal to the same as we would have if we were litigating in
well,
court.
Well, in answers to Judge Hurwitz's question, it all seems the same, whether it's arbitration or otherwise. I still don't know any palpable terms in which your clients are disadvantaged.
Well,
if
between
they go
arbitration and being and able to litigate a claim in court, I mean, you know, under the, I mean,
the outcomes are equally binding, right?
Yeah. Unfortunately, well, the Supreme Court's told us that you can't tell us that court's better than arbitration. So you're stuck with that presumption.
You have used up your time, but I do want to get your position on one thing, and that is the standing of Tidelands to participate in arbitration if that is what turns out to be the case.
What we brought was a declaratory relief claim. We didn't bring the wage claims against Tidelands in the city of Long Beach. The issue of whether or not...
Oh, but you allege in the complaint that the Tidelands and the city of Long Beach are agents of Nabors.
What we say is that the parties are agents of one another. Technically, a closer analysis would be that Nabors, who was a subcontractor to Tidelands, is the agent of Tidelands because the contract is between the city and Tidelands. However,
well, we take your complaint on face value at this
right.
stage of the proceedings, and since you've alleged that they are agents, I don't understand how it is that they would be excluded from the arbitration.
Well, we think that the declaratory relief issue of whether or not the project is a public work should be resolved by the court and that they're not technically a party to the arbitration agreement because the agreement...
Do you think the two separate... So let's assume that we order your individual clients to arbitration. You think your clients get to arbitrate a claim against Nabors about whether they're entitled to prevailing wages because this is a public project, but the court at the same time will be making a separate determination between your clients and Tidelands in the city about whether they're subject to the prevailing wage statute?
We would ask the court to bifurcate it to determine the declaratory relief issue first and then determine whether or not it's a legal issue, so to determine whether or not the project is a public work, which
Which is the only issue in this case, period, right?
Well, there's issues relating to amounts of damages and things like that. But a paramount issue is...
But if it's not a public work, you lose.
It would definitely...
It's not good for you.
I wouldn't say that, because there are potential other arguments to make, but it would be devastating to the
plaintiff. Well, put it differently. If the employer's not subject to the prevailing wage statute, you don't prevail.
On that cause of action, that's correct. And so the way we had approached this was we thought the arbitration agreement was unconscionable and therefore we should bifurcate it. Could I make one point on the
very quickly
on the procedural unconscionability? What I think is critical, the plaintiffs have to agree to the arbitration agreement as a condition of applying for employment, not as a condition of employment. And that first page that they have to sign when they apply says the agreement may be available for you, but it's not presented to them. My argument on the procedural unconscionability is when you look at it from that context, it's actually very high procedural unconscionability.
Thank you, counsel. Thank you. Each of you has 1 minute for rebuttal.
So 1 minute, 2 points, quickly. First, with regard to PAGA, if the plaintiff can settle or dismiss a PAGA claim, and also has the authority to bind the state to a forum, and the language from SACOB that Judge Graber cited supports this position. Secondarily, with regard to the PAGA question, which has been quite a point of discussion today, it's a very dynamic area of the law. There have been a lot of, as Judge Hurwitz noted, some mem dispos by this court, one as recently as Friday on this point. And there have been many decisions by the courts of appeal, although not the state Supreme Court. And so if
have there
this,
been decisions by the California, any California court
no,
of
there
appeal
have,
on this issue, the one that we're talking about, whether or not PAGA claims are arbitrable?
There have been actually decisions really all over the map with regard to how to interpret.
I tried to do some research and I'm unaware of any. Are you aware of any?
There are some that analyze the issue in terms of pre-dispute versus post-dispute and the power of the plaintiff to bind the state with regard to that.
Those I know. But are there any
specifically about arbitration?
Yes, specifically that say that PAGA claims are subject to arbitration.
Or not.
Depending on how they look at the question, given some of the dicta in Ascani, and some of them do.
But no, I'm aware of our decisions. And I'm aware of the California Supreme Court decision.
Correct.
I'm asking you, are there any California Court of Appeal decisions addressing this issue?
Yes, there are some that approach it from as I said, from different angles, depending on
specifically
what your premise
about
is.
Arbitrability.
Yes, with regard to whether plaintiffs can bind by pre-dispute or post-dispute.
No, that's a separate issue. My question is there a case that either says PAGA claims are arbitrable or they're not arbitrable?
No.
Okay. I didn't think there was one.
Yeah,
I'm sorry.
No.
Thank you, counsel.
But what I was going to request was, if you are very interested in this, that we the parties, have not really fully vetted all of these cases because many of them came after our briefing. So if you are interested, I would
request... But you have the ability under 28J to file supplemental cases.
Yeah, I understand but...
At this point, I'm not inclined to ask for supplemental briefing.
We'll consider your request. Thank you, counsel.
Okay, thank you.
A few quick points, Your Honors. The claim with regard to the declaratory relief claim, the contract as a whole is a very large project. It deals with the oil drilling down in the lands in Long Beach, as well as certain other projects that are going on there. The issue involving Nabors is a small subset of that entire thing. So whether and to what extent the work that Nabors was doing is one that was on a public work or not, will be an issue that will impact the claims against Nabors, and it is a very smaller subset about, you know, the entire contract.
It may not resolve whether all work on the project.
That's completely right, Your Honor. But the point is that they're inextricably intertwined, and where the claims against my client are inextricably intertwined against the claims with the party with the arbitration agreement, then the doctrine of equitable estoppel would say that we are entitled to enforce the arbitration agreement and participate in the arbitration. Two decisions of this court, one from last year, Poublon versus C.H. Robinson, directly addresses the issue of whether the unilateral modification of the right to...
Counsel, that was not discussed, and so that's not fair rebuttal, that the unilateral modification was not discussed. So.
Fair enough, Your Honor. With regard to the the costs issue, this court's decision in Kilgore versus Key Bank, as well as the Supreme Court's decision in Greentree Financial versus Randolph, both of those cases determined that if there was no cost provision at all, that the agreements nevertheless would be enforceable, where especially there's no evidence that the costs will be so prohibitive as to prevent the plaintiffs to vindicate their rights. So we believe that the cost issue, although it can be severable, although it can be interpreted consistent with the law, it also is one that wouldn't provide grounds for declaring the agreement unconscionable.
Thank you, counsel.
Thank you, Your Honor.
That case just argued is submitted, and we appreciate the very interesting arguments from all three counsel.